Good afternoon. I thank the IMA Kodambakkam branch for giving this opportunity. And I thank the Dr. Subramaniam and Dr. Chandrasekhar for pre-calling my talk also. Thank you very much. Infection prevention is old age. I find very difficult to define the old age because these people are yet to leave the party as well as the nation. But this man is old enough to retire. I really do not know what is the age group to define as an old age. That's a problem I face. So I started googling it there. Googling says it's easy to find who is the old age there. This is a simple tool you can use whether you are old or young there. But I really do not know to define how is the old age is there. So for me as an infectious disease consultant, any age is 10 age to get vaccination. You are never too old to get rid of vaccination there. You are always young to get vaccination. That's what my team. And we have already written in the newspapers there, mentioning vaccine is not only for kids. But unfortunately, today when I googled it there, today is the day for polio day. What is adult vaccinations in India? This picture comes. Adult is vaccinating a child. That is adult vaccinations in India. It is not other way. They are never taking vaccines there. Only adult is giving vaccines to child. This is the status of adult vaccinations in India. So my objective today is adult vaccinations, only for adults. Vaccines will work. Second thing, what's the recommendations we have? What is the way forward we consider? This is a burden of infectious diseases. This article presented a couple of months back in NEJM. It shows what is the burden of infectious diseases there. This is global burden. If we say people, 58 million people are dying in the world due to various causes, but 25% is due to infectious diseases alone there. This is the burden of infectious diseases we are facing now. This is a December NEJM article there. And if we go into the WHO, if we see what are the top 10 causes of death, almost 6 causes occupied by infections, whether it's a respiratory tract infections or diarrheal illness or STD or HIV or TB or malaria, this is the top 6 causes of WHO leading causes of infection. So this is an infection. That's why Mayan predicted in 2012 the world is going to over. Infection is going to take over and Mayan predicted. But fortunately we have survived. We have survived December 21, Mayan prediction became wrong there. Why adult vaccinations? The infections are not common to children. It is common to adults also because our immunity wanes over time. Whatever our immune system gains during initial stages, as we progress in age, our immune system becomes wanes. And we are vulnerable to a lot of infections and we are getting severe infections. And once you got hospitalized, the mortality as well as morbidity is very high. The deaths due to vaccine preventable disease is high in adults compared to children, but we are vaccinating children, but actual data shows the number of people dying due to vaccine preventable deaths is high in adult populations compared to the pediatric populations there. So this is one scenario. We have got infections happening everywhere, and as an adult, my immunity will get way over a period of time. I'm vulnerable to severe infections. Whether if I got infected, whether I got all the antibiotics to treat my infections, this is I already spoken to this same audience couple of months back there. What is the role of antibiotics? 1940s to 1960s, golden time of antibiotics. All the antibiotics are invented. That's why the Surgeon General in 1969 US Assembly told, this is the time we can close the chapter on infectious diseases. We have won the chapter, we have won the battle on infectious diseases. 1985, some antibiotics came into the market. 2010, what happened? No antibiotic has come into the market. This is the status. Our antibiotic pipeline is very much dry. It's not going to happen in 1 year, 2 year. You are going to wait for nearly 10 years to get good antibiotics against gram-negative infections. This is our pipeline. Everybody knows it. That's why Louis Pasteur, couple of centuries back in call, he predicted, even he was meditating over a disease, he said it's very difficult to find a solution to a disease. So what he suggests is, it's easy to prevent a disease rather than treat a disease there. That's what Dr. Louis Pasteur was predicted couple of centuries back, you can call it there. And this is even more scary there. If I show four scenarios, can you say which is a dangerous one there? The first one is flying a charter flight in a windy weather. Can you call it a dangerous one? It's not a regular flight. It's your own flight. You ask Dr. Akshay already, then you can know the thing there. Then this is having a Kudumkulam project. That's a nuclear power plant in your own city. How safe it is? Nobody knows the answer. A lot of discussions going on there. And playing for Indian cricket, I do not know. If we lose Test series against Australia, whether the Dhoni will retain or Tendulkar will retire. So many changes will happen if we lose the series. I do not know Indian cricket is a dangerous game, but playing a dangerous game is serious thing or not? That's a question I'm asking you there. Then fourth thing is getting admitted to the hospital. Can you rate which one is a dangerous one there?
Hospital.
I'll define. This is the data. How will you define the dangerous things? If the event happened more than one occasion on 1,000 exposures. If the event occurs one occasion on more than 1,000 exposures, it's called dangerous. What are the three dangerous things? Getting admitted to the hospital, mountain climbing, taking part in dangerous sports. This is dangerous things. What is ultra safe? When the event happened less than one occasion on more than 100,000 exposures. More than 1,00,000 exposure, if the event happened less than one occasion, that is called nuclear power plant. If you got a nuclear power plant, it is ultra safe. But getting admitted to the hospital is dangerous thing. This is US data, custom data. Indian data, I do not know how safe our hospitals are there. But what are the steps to prevent infections? There are a lot of community activities there. You can have a safe water, you should inhibit smoking, you do things there. Among the things, what is the one single most strategy is vaccinations. Vaccinations will definitely prevent a lot of infections. And if the person has got admitted to the hospital, what other things can prevent infection? Again, vaccination will prevent infections. You can remove the catheters out. You can remove the catheters. Unnecessary things should not be done. These are the things you can avoid. But the first step is how to prevent infections in hospitalized patients, vaccinate the patients. Whether in the community or in the hospital, vaccination is definitely working for you there. I am not a public health professional to speak about providing a safe water and other thing there. I am an ID consultant there. So, what is the impact of vaccinations? Vaccination will definitely reduce the mortality and morbidity. This is the data for measles. Once you start vaccinating in the measles between 1950s, what happened? Measles is now a disease of almost few cases are reporting to the measles. This is the incidence of measles after the vaccinations campaign started in 1954. Even I show more data. This is an Indian data. If you start vaccinating for measles, you not only reduce the measles, but you can improve the mortality of the child. You can improve the survival of the child. This study is conducted in India. It got published in 2003 there. So vaccines will not only control the particular disease, but also control the reduces the mortality rate there. Vaccines and polio. What happened to the polio? Polio is eradicated all over the world. Except four countries we are reporting there. India, Pakistan, Nigeria, and Afghanistan. These are the four countries reporting polio. That's why today the oral polio campaign is still going on. Last 2 years we are not reporting. If we are successful this year also, maybe our name will be eradicated from this map there. Till that point of time, we are reporting cases of polio. Other countries are eradicated of this polio. Why? Their vaccination strategy is better. Even more, if you start vaccinating for pneumococcal for the children, pneumococcal vaccines introduced in some other country, what has resulted in the pneumococcal vaccinations? Pneumococcal vaccination reduces adult pneumococcal disease. It reduces adult pneumococcal disease. It's called the herd effect. Overall herd effect is going up. If you start vaccinating your child, you all get protected there. This is an effect we can see with pneumococcal vaccinations there. This is even more. If you got taken influenza vaccinations, the chances of cardiac disease, the chances of cerebrovascular disease, the chances of pneumonia and influenza will definitely come down. So if you are vaccinating, you can cut down the particular disease. Second thing, you can improve the mortality. You can cut down your death rates. You can prevent a lot of uneventful events like cardiovascular events and cerebrovascular events. And you can protect your elderly people for vaccinating children itself there. That's why the MMRWR, what has recommended every year, they give the recommendations. This year recommendation has just come out. Last week only it has come out in February 2013. What are the vaccines as an adult you supposed to take? These are the vaccines recommended by MMWR 2013. February 1st week, if you go to the CDC website, this is the vaccinations recommended by MMWR. First thing is, every year you're supposed to take flu vaccine. Flu vaccine available month of October, you're supposed to take flu vaccine. Particularly if you're a healthcare worker, you're supposed to take flu vaccine. Then Tdap, tetanus, diphtheria, acellular pertussis. Every 10 years, people always take one dose of tetanus following injury 6 months. It's not needed. If you've taken proper Tdap, it's not needed to take tetanus once in 6 months there. So tetanus, diphtheria, acellular pertussis, once in 10 years, it's needed there. What are the other vaccines that's required? These are the vaccines is mandatory there. Zoster vaccine, but Zoster vaccine is unfortunately not available in India. Zoster vaccine is needed. Then what are the other vaccines supposed to take in there? With certain indications, like pneumococcal vaccines. Pneumococcal vaccines, previously they considered elderly age group. 65 years and above, one dose is mandatory. But now, we got a good pneumococcal vaccines. So the age group is reduced to even 19 years and above if you got some comorbid illness like diabetes, CKD, uncontrolled hypertension, coronary heart disease, anything you're supposed to take one dose of pneumococcal vaccines. That is, the recommendations are changing. Again, hepatitis A and hepatitis B has gone full recommendations there. If you are not taking hepatitis B, if you have not had jaundice in your young age, you're supposed to take hepatitis. So these are all the vaccine recommendations by US CDC, ACIP if you call, Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices there. We have also formed some guidelines in 2009. The Indian College of Physicians, Associations of Physicians of India has formulated some guidelines on vaccinations. And we have written for Tamil Nadu also, we have written article in TAPIJ article saying what is the recommendations for vaccinations for our people. This is our own article we have written a couple of months, couple of years back. Whether APA and ACP are same, we are just copying from the same or we want to be different. Because we don't want to copy from one source and we can label it with a same copy of ACAP. There are a lot of recommendations between tetanus, diphtheria, pertussis, what I was telling there. APA, India is saying yes to the ACAP. Similarly, for human papillomavirus vaccine also, both are replicating. Varicella, they are replicating. Zoster is not available in India. They are recommended by advisory committee there. Measles, mumps, rubella, they are replicating. Only two vaccines are differing between India and Western societies. Influenza, we say no. Pneumococcal vaccines, we say no. This is 2009 recommendations. This is 2013 recommendations. We have not updated our guidelines, basically. So this is a case study. In fact, this is a cardiothoracic surgeon, leading cardiothoracic surgeon, Chennai. 50-year-old, he is a diabetic, admitted in Jan 2003, fever of 2 days duration, hot tests and sodium. Here the stage, in background, he got no immunizations in the last couple of years. On examination, confused, febrile, bilateral extensor, and rest of 6M examination, normal. On investigations, leukocytosis, malarial parasite negative, exchanges normal, MRI shows some mastoiditis. There is no need to pray, this is very easy to make a diagnosis. With the CSF report of sugar of 10, protein of 320 and cell count of 5000, polymorphs of 98%, it is encephalitis, you can call it that. And blood culture grew streptococcal pneumonia. Blood culture grew streptococcal pneumonia, the diagnosis is invasive pneumococcal disease. I'm not talking about a single case of it. What is the estimated annual burden of pneumococcal disease? Pneumococcal infections are major causes of morbidity and mortality. Streptococcal pneumonia is a leading cause of pneumonia, as well as otitis media. Pneumonia infections causes more than 1 million deaths worldwide. This is a state globally I can tell. If you see the Lancet paper 2009, what is the incidence of pneumonia, streptococcal pneumonia, among less than 5 years? India has got a huge population. That's why our incidence of streptococcal pneumonia is very high. Even though our mortality is not compared to Afghanistan, but the number is huge. So even if you got less mortality, the number wise, we are leading numbers producing streptococcal pneumonia related deaths. This is Lancet paper 2009. You can have it there. All the serotypes are prevalent in India. Most of the serotypes are prevalent in India. If you see, this serotypes is not common in India. No. If you do a study, you can find all the serotypes there. And nasopharyngeal carriage is not necessarily cause a disease. But if you see our neighbor, Pakistan has got maximum number of nasopharyngeal carriage compared to any other persons. If you go into pneumococcal pneumonia per se, what is the cause for the pneumococcal pneumonia? Or you can see communicable pneumonia. Again, this is an Indian study. If you see, streptococcal pneumonia is a leading cause of pneumonia in India. So, nasal carriage is high, all the serotypes are common. If you see the community for pneumonia, streptococcal pneumonia is again leading cause of it. So you can't hide your pneumococcus. I say I have not seen my pneumococcus in my country. If you start seeing pneumococcus, definitely you can see the pneumococcus. That's the thing there. But unfortunately, APA recommends there is no need for pneumococcal vaccines in this part of country in 2009 because they are telling the vaccine is not effective at all. But nowadays, they themselves told with the availability of new vaccines, this recommendations may change. So in 2013, we are expecting APA will change the recommendations there. But all other countries, US, you can see, if the person has got some comorbid conditions or if the person has got more than age of 64, you're supposed to take pneumococcal vaccinations. Now with the newer conjugate vaccines, the age limit is cut down to 50 years. If you are 50 plus, you're supposed to take pneumococcal conjugate vaccines. If you got underlying comorbid conditions, irrespective of any age, you're supposed to take pneumococcal vaccinations like diabetes, CKD, or the person has got COPD, smoking, even morbid obesity, you're supposed to take pneumococcal vaccinations. This is the recommendations. Other international, not only I'm quoting US, all countries, Canada, UK, Australia, if you go there, pneumococcal vaccination is mandatory if you cross the age of 50 or 64 there. That is why WHO also changed the recommendations in September 2012. Pneumococcal vaccination is required for persons older than age of 65. IAP, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, already taken and included the guidelines. Now our Indian Geriatric Society also includes the guidelines. Two forms of pneumococcal vaccines are available, both the pneumovax as well as conjugate vaccine. The Prodan is available there. So Indian guidelines says both the vaccines are recommended. Any vaccines you can take it there. This is Indian Geriatric Society guidelines released last year there. So Indian Society of Pediatrics has taken, Indian Society of Geriatrics has taken, and all other international societies are recommending pneumococcal vaccinations there. What about influenza? Again, influenza, JPA says this is the age group you're supposed to take, or this is a list of conditions you're supposed to take for influenza vaccinations. They put healthcare workers as one of the indications, but unfortunately, most of the healthcare workers are not taking influenza vaccine regularly, routinely every year. We are suffering, but we are not taking the vaccinations there. We are one of the important persons supposed to take according to Indian guidelines. But what is the Western guidelines? Everybody above the age of 6 months supposed to take influenza vaccinations yearly. It's not for your sake. If you got flu, it will be lasted for a couple of days and flu will be get it off for you. But if you got an elderly person staying with you, the flu will transmit it to the elderly person, even suffer and you will die there. Similarly, if you got an younger age group, a kid with you, if the kid picks the infections from you, for the kid it will become a severe infections. So for the sake of people living in your house, take influenza vaccinations. That's why the recommendation is more than 6 months you're supposed to take influenza vaccinations every year. As an healthcare provider, you're supposed to take influenza vaccination there. This is the recommendations for influenza. Whether influenza is common in our part, this is a multi-site study. One of the center is King Institute, Chennai has participated in the study. Influenza is reported throughout. From 2004 to 2008, they did their surveillance. They found influenza is reported throughout. If you see what is the season of influenza, tropical country there is no season, usually we recommend. But if you see Chennai, October to December, maximum flu is circulating there. Supposed to take flu so that you can prevent the flu vaccinations. This is during the time of pandemic influenza. What happened to the persons? Almost 25% of the people reported tested positive for flu there. So this is a prevalence of flu vaccinations. This is a prevalence of flu everywhere. And pandemic flu is not a milder form of disease, I can call it. It's a severe form. Compared to 1918 Spanish flu, it is not that severe. But compared to the rest of flu happened after 1988, after 1918, this flu is more dangerous there. So this is the impact of flu killing people there. And every year, every week we are reporting to the World Health Organization's lot of flu cases. This is September 2012, I have not updated my slide there. This is every week we are reporting, and we are reporting more number of cases. If you see the map, India is reporting more number of flu cases to the world. So flu is common, pneumonia is common, but still our recommendations is not there. That's the problem. But international organizations recommend after the age of 6 months, you're supposed to take flu vaccines. After the age of 50, you're supposed to take the pneumococcal vaccinations there. This is healthcare worker during the time of pandemic influenza. What is the vaccine uptake? Swine flu was common at that point of time. 2010, the study was conducted. What is the uptake of H1N1 flu vaccines among the healthcare worker? 65% of the people taken during the time of swine flu. What happened? I subsequently conducted a study next year, 2011. What happened? Only 15% of the people has taken the flu vaccine there. Healthcare worker I am talking about. The recommendation is everybody after the age of 6 months, but you yourself not taking the vaccinations. That's the recommendations there. So what is the future of vaccinations? So this is a good article, January 24th, NEJ was written, because we know antibiotics is not going to come. The end of antibiotics has happened and resistance is killing us. So how to tackle the antibiotic resistance? John Bartlett has written what are the solutions he's giving thing there. There are four important solutions he's giving. We should change the way we practice the thing there. We should find what will happen. Instead of administering a drug through the vein and cannula, we should find some nanotechnologies to administer a drug to the site of injections. That should happen there. And second thing, we should regenerative processes, not like metallic processes. We should have a regenerative processes to cut down the infections. And we need to find out vaccines to prevent the antibiotic resistance against bacteria there. These are all the important strategies Bartlett is discussing in January 4th, 24th article on NEJM there. This is one of the interesting articles we can see, because antibiotics is not going to come. So here these talks will happen more, how to get rid of this antibiotics resistant bacteria. So these are the solutions they are postulating. And what is the status? Already studies have started, already work has started there. We want to control this problem there. So in short, what are the things you need? If you are 65, but now I can control if you are 50 plus, because old age is very difficult to define. So if you are 50 plus, you're supposed to take flu vaccine every year. Pneumococcal vaccine one shot is required there. So this is the recommendations for persons above the age of 50. If you are a healthcare worker, what are the vaccines you're supposed to take? flu vaccine is mandatory. Every year is supposed to take. You're supposed to take measles comes rubella. Whether you're working in a pediatric setting or OG setting or not, you're supposed to take measles comes rubella. Hepatitis B is mandatory. Tdap. Every 10 years, you're supposed to take one Tdap followed by TD. And you're supposed to take varicella zoster provided you have not chickenpox in your young age. So these are all the vaccines recommended for healthcare workers. If you are a diabetic, coronary heart disease, COPD, flu vaccine, pneumonia, hepatitis B is mandatory. 2012 recommendations, all diabetics supposed to take hepatitis B vaccinations. That's the recommendations for diabetic. Pregnant lady, flu is mandatory and TD or Tdap is mandatory. Tdap, after the peak of 27 weeks onwards, you can give Tdap. All other things, TD as well as flu vaccine is required. If you are going to college, if you are going to stay in the university campus, ideally you take MMR as well as measles vaccination, meningococcal vaccinations. These are the vaccinations in short you're supposed to take as an adult, apart from your own risk of typhoid, apart from your own risk of hepatitis A, whether you had hepatitis A in the past or not, you're supposed to take. This is the nutshell I can put it there. Why these vaccinations? We are living in the era of global warming. There is no good antibiotics. Vaccines will protect them. We don't have any good antibiotics. We are not going to get good antibiotics also there. We are living in a global antibiotic. We are living with our friend NDM1. This is a resistance pattern I am seeing every day. Ordinary E. coli resistance to everything there. This is a pattern I am seeing there. So you are living with NDM1. We are living. And infectious diseases specialty is a rare specialty. People never call infectious diseases and people are never available also there. So bodyguards are very difficult to find there. And even if the infectious disease says something there, people won't accept the thing there. We know antibiotics. We are using antibiotics for time and time. We don't want any antibiotic advice from you people. This man tried something that can change the behavior. He told the people, he find out what will happen. Before conducting delivery, without hand wash, the doctors are conducting delivery before, without doing the hand wash. The mortality is very high. He told the doctors, please wash your hands. Once he start doing the interventions, what happened? The death in the doctors connected delivery has come down equal to the nurses there. Nurses are washing the hands. Doctors are not washing in 1847. I'm talking about 1847 when this man did the thing there. Simple thing, wash your hands in lime water. This man, but what happened to this man? Within 4 years, how the look has changed? Within 47 years, he's gone. So it's very difficult to change the behavior of the people there. It's very difficult to change the behavior. It's injurious to me there if I want to change the antibiotic prescribing practices there. So prevention is primary. Take your vaccinations. Your belief won't even make you a better person, but your behavior certainly makes you a better person there. So take vaccines, whatever recommended for you as well as recommended for your persons. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Floor is open for questions. It's an important topic.
If you have not jaundice, if you have not jaundice in your young age, you're supposed to give hepatitis A along with hepatitis B. There are two vaccines available. Hepatitis A means Havirix we can available. If you want to give hepatitis A and hepatitis B, Tiltrix is available there. Both combinations of hepatitis A and hepatitis B there.
I'm a hematologist and I do refer patients to splenectomy. What is the current guideline now for splenectomy, post-splenectomy vaccine?
Pre-splenectomy ideal time there, before 2 weeks of the splenectomy, if it's a planned splenectomy, 2 weeks before splenectomy, you're supposed to give pneumococcal vaccinations, H1B vaccinations, Haemophilus influenza type B vaccinations, meningococcal vaccinations. But if the splenectomy is an emergency surgery, at the time of discharge, you can allow the person to recover from the illness. At the time of discharge, you can give 3 vaccines there, both pneumococcal, H1B, Haemophilus influenza type B, as well as meningococcal. Meningococcal, H influenza type B, the chances of occurrence is less, but ideally you're supposed to give it.
What about post-splenectomy after 5 years or something?
There is no need for any redosing of pneumococcal vaccinations. Once a person underwent splenectomy, once he crossed the age of 50 years or 65 years, according to the previous guidelines, 65 years, according to the recent guidelines, 50 years, once he crossed the age of 50 years, one more repeat dose is needed there.
Extra precaution for malaria for post-splenectomy patients.
In our part, it's very difficult there.
So
we can't prevent malaria in our part.
No, is there any recommendation you can give chemoprophylaxis for?
That's what I said. Chemoprophylaxis won't work. Ask the person to sleep in a netted room, AC room, netted room, apply Odomos or some mosquito repellent. That's the best thing there. We can't give lifelong chemoprophylaxis. As long as you are living in India, till the death, you are exposed to malaria. So we can't give lifelong chemoprophylaxis. Travelers coming to India, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, you can give prophylaxis. But you are going to live in this tropical country, there is no role for lifelong chemoprophylaxis. Only thing, avoid mosquito contact things there. What are things we can do? Use full sleeves, don't go in the thing there. These are things, but practically it's not possible.
Did you write about all these recommendations in Stima or Jima, or have you taken steps?
We have written on tapage, we have written the thing, the same article has shown the thing that what are the challenges we are facing in tapage, what are the problem we are facing, adult vaccinations. When we talk about adult vaccinations, people in the month of June, July, particularly the college students, they want to go to US for MS study there. They will find very difficult there. The age of 20, 21 there, pediatrician say you are no more a child to get vaccinated from me there. And if you go to the adult physician says, I do not know about the vaccinations. I can give certificate, you are vaccinated, everything there. You can show to the US people there. But this is the situations we are facing there. That's why we have opened up some of the adult vaccinations clinic also there.
Now, I'm asking you, have you taken any steps to educate the doctors?
We have taken an initiative.
JIMA is a Tamil Nadu Indian Medical Association journal, and JIMA is a journal of Indian Medical Association. Please write about those things. Please take steps.
Sure.
No other questions. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.